PhD. My name is Michelle, and I'm coming to you in 220 CE with the breaking news of the overthrow of Emperor Zhang. He has abdicated power to Cao Pi. What does this mean for the future of the Han Dynasty? Only time will tell. My correspondent, Kyle Van Veen, is with the ex-emperor right now. Let's see what he has to say. Kyle?
Thanks, Michelle. I'm here with ex-emperor Xi Yan. I was wondering, how exactly did your empire fall?
Well, Kyle, after Deng Xiao rose against the country, it was divided into three countries. I was a puppet emperor for Cao Cao for decades. He made laws that helped himself while he passed under my name. Eventually, I abdicated power to Cao Cao's son, Cao Pi, and the dynasty ended.
Now, ex-emperor Xi Yan, I understand there was some tension between the eunuchs and the Confucianists. What do you have to say about that?
Well, there's a huge conflict between the eunuchs and the Confucianists. When the eunuchs got the power, Confucianists protested against it. But there are also other factors like decline in agricultural production or constant rebellion that weakened the state, not only the conflict between the eunuchs and the Confucianists.
So, what do you think is next for the future of the Han Dynasty?
I think the weak government leadership and corrupted officials will make those people to suffer for years and years. But I'll be fine.
Thank you to Kyle and ex-emperor for that interview. It'll be interesting to see what's in store next for him. Now on to a different cause for the fall of the Han Dynasty. This actually happened around 40 years ago, but its effect is still seen today. It was based on Taoism, and also because of Yellow River flooding, epidemics, and landlessness. It was called the Yellow Turban Rebellion, and it eventually gained over 360,000 armed followers. We've dug at some old footage on this from Kyle Van Veen's first field report. Let's take a look.
It's me, Kyle Van Veen, my first field report. I'm here at the scene of the Yellow Turban Rebellion in 186. I think I can hear him in the woods now as we speak.
So, I am here with someone from the Yellow Turban Rebellion.
Howdy.
Howdy. Gross hands. So,
sorry.
I would like to ask, why did you join the rebellion?
Well, I've been a peasant for the last 15 years, and I've been working my butt off, but I don't make that much money, and there's huge taxes. The rich keep getting richer, and it's ticking me off.
Now, where did you join the rebellion? Near the Yellow River, like the rest?
Yeah, I guess so. I guess you could say that.
Well, that is quite an interesting story, and that was just a delightful experience.
Thank you.
Yeah, go back out there.
Wasn't that a nice trip back in time? Kyle hasn't aged a bit. The Yellow Turban Rebellion was working toward the Great Peace, which meant equality, social harmony, and public ownership of everything by the state. Eventually, it was suppressed by the military. However, it devastated China, weakened the state, and eventually contributed to the overthrow of the Han Dynasty around 40 years later. On to a different conflict that caused chaos in the social structure of China. Landlords and peasants emerged during the Han Dynasty. Population growth, taxes, and indebtedness led to the emergence of a landlord class, who could avoid taxes and increase the tax burden on the poor. Peasants had to sell their land and work for the landlords, and the landowning class, also called scholar gentry, reflected their twin sources of privilege, education and wealth. And now to our foreign correspondent, David Doe, who has an interview with a landlord.
Hi. Today I'm going to introduce Song Hao in the land of Xi'an. Hi. Can you tell me about yourself?
Well, I'm a rich landlord and I have lots of peasants. I avoid paying taxes after I bought the land from the peasants, and they have to pay heavy taxes because they're not in with the officials like I am.
So you must have a very good life.
Yes, I do have a very good life. I could raise an army at any time if I wanted. I could start a rebellion. I could possibly even overthrow the government.
That's very cool. Nice knowing you, Zhang Hao.
Thank you. Have a good day, sir.
You too. Well, let me ask you a last question.
All right.
How is the life of your peasants?
Well, I've never been a peasant, but I think it's pretty good. I treat them fairly well and give them gifts when they need it, help them and give them time off, and I don't think there's ever a chance of rebellion in my estate.
Cool.
for that, David, but I don't think life for the peasants was as good as the landlord made it sound. They had to pay a lot of the tax burden, since it mostly fell on them, with the avoidance of taxes by the wealthy. Also, they had to donate a month of public service project time per year, and they also had to be conscripted to 2 years of military service in their lifetime. A lot of them turned to being bandits or beggars, since they couldn't keep up with the economic demands of life in China. And ultimately, their struggles are what led to a lot of the problems that led to the fall of the Han Dynasty. We've got a lot of good data from the field, so now let's head over to the news desk and check in with our analysts to see what they think about all this.
We've already talked with Emperor Zhan about the Yellow Turban Rebellion and along with the relationships between the peasants and the landlords. So what are some other reasons for collapse, and what are its effects?
Basically, the dynasty got too big and overextended itself. That's why it fell victim to so many foreign invaders. Also, it got too expensive to maintain. There were smallpox that periodically ravaged the population. Finally, there was no fundamental technological breakthroughs to increase productivity and advance the empire.
Confucianism is the school of thought that governed the Han Dynasty for its many years of existence. It took some of the qualities of legalism, the previous belief, but moderated its policies so it was less harsh. Confucianism established China's imperial state and established its political patterns as well. One such pattern was the establishment of Wudi's Imperial Academy. It allowed for social mobility in a culture that otherwise lacked it most of the time. Confucian values were taught in this academy in order to prep men to serve in the civil service. This Confucian basis was what formed the structure of the Han Dynasty. But with its collapse, will it be lost?
All right. Confucianism has been the ruling order of China for many years under the Han Dynasty, but it seems like a new way of thinking is taking hold. With the country in chaos, people seem to be turning to a new way of thinking called Taoism. It's from Lao Tzu, a 6th century archivist who wrote the Tao Te Ching.
They're counteracting all the disorder by encouraging withdrawal into nature and encouraging spontaneous, individualistic, and natural behavior. Supposedly, nature and its patterns will help unify the country again after the fall of this dynasty. What will this new way of thinking bring to China? We'll have to see what happens next.
Thanks for the great analysis from our news desk. That pretty much wraps up all we've got about the Han Dynasty's fall today, but for our final story, we've got Jake with a special report from the field, where nomadic invaders from the north have started to settle down. Jake?
Hi, Jake Quarles here from HD News. Today, I'm at the Great Wall, where barbarians from the north and nomads have breached our defenses and are now setting up barbarian states in our dynasty. With the Great Wall and the relentless trade opportunities and gifts that we've proposed to them, along with marriage alliances and military campaigns, they have still managed to break through and are now getting angry with our dynasty. Here, take a look now. Now, back to you, Michelle.
And that wraps up our broadcast for tonight. I hope all you guys enjoyed it. Unfortunately, this will be my last time signing off because Han Dynasty News is going out of business with the fall of the Han Dynasty. And with that, thank you to all my foreign correspondents and interviewers, and that's all for tonight. Stay classy, China.
I'm gonna perfect my dumpling. My mother liked them a lot. Well, if I don't get assassinated by...
encouraging spontaneous and natural behaviors.
Rich keeps getting richer and it's pissing me off.
No, you can't say that either.
It's pissing me off.
Yeah.
Afternoon, sir.
Howdy.
So, how's it like as a peasant? Dynasty.
Sorry, sir, I'm working.
Oh, you are? I got the permission.
I don't believe that.
Oh, well, I'm pretty sure that you're hardworking, but you are paying a lot of taxes, right?
Sorry, sir.
Hey! Quit talking about peasants! Get out of here! Get back to work!
Sorry.